I would like to do one more structure for you, but I will not do it in the face of the froth of your verbal diarrhea. There are many things to wade through, and some of them are very difficult, but verbal diarrhea is a monstrous stream to broach. I would like to do for you the origin of the Chastity belt. This is a very intricate, very difficult, powerful affair. But if you feel that you should revert once again, monsters, please. You blasted little monsters. You be quiet a moment, please. Let me have the rain here. Just a moment, please. I mean, it's well to have a good time, but you shouldn't insult other people while you're doing it, because that's beggarly. Not in keeping with royalty, not in keeping with the proper thought. I'm certain that I'll have plenty of food for all of you if you're kind enough to give me your individual singular attention. I'm going to take a shot at this, and if you override me, it will cause me to lose the coloring of my tempo, and I'll quit, and I'll try it again another time. But I should like to do this for you. This is called the origin of the Chastity belt. The Chastity belt, if you know it or not, was a little belt that went around a young lady's midriff in such a manner as to hold her secure. It's a very interesting affair. I did a good deal of research on it, and some research. And I found out, by integrity, here we go, the exact origin of the Chastity belt. Between the 14th and the 15th centuries, there was a tremendous metal epidemic swept the land. Everyone was going in search of the Holy Grail. Few of the beggars knew what it was, and those who had the least inkling of it blew it up to such fantastic proportions that they're all going, you know. You're going, Fred?
You're going, Harry, yes. Good, we'll go. John's going to make it all together.
The Duke of Clintspot, standing in his courtyard, working his vice weapon down. He doesn't want the beggar to get hung up in the middle of the fakers. There's much activity taking place in the courtyard. The various knaves and grooms are busy with the movement of the horses and so on and so forth, the jingle of the spurs and the neighing of the horses. And finally, out of the smoke of one of the forges, three forges going, and then out of the smoke of one of the forges comes a little character, and he says to the Duke, "Sire, our master,
Spouse! Don't put that horse over there, you jackass over there. That's better.
Activity, 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 activity." And he comes in, "Sire, I realize that I take my very head in my hands when I ask you for a few moments of your precious time, our immortal master. But I've conceived something in my fancy I'm certain will please you most wonderfully well." Very well. Boom, they open the door, and there on the table is a beautiful golden belt. Yes. It is not studded with jewels. It is embraced jewels, and all about it are little phallic figurines. Each and every one of them engraved in virgin pearls. So the Duke looks at this jeweler's masterpiece. Rather than being highly flattered, he blows his words out and says, "How dare you bring me here to see a common-only belt with a few jewels on it, knowing that I'm going in search of the grail, busy man that I am, fooling me with a common belt with a few jewels on it. Before the sun rises in the morning, you'll be singing soprano." He said, "Sire, it's not a belt." "It's a Chastity belt, your grace." "What? A Chastity belt, your majesty, to preserve the honor of your lady fair, while you, brave one, go in search of the grail." "By gad, sheer genius.
Make me 12 at once. He had a few friends he wanted to cover. Now the scene switches.
The Duke is now a handsome, magnificent Negro Duke. He's climbing the spiral staircase to the Queen's boudoir. He has a Chastity belt behind him. And while he's making the ascent, he's waving his brains for a piece of conversational putty whereby he may introduce this new and unusual affair to Her Grace in such a manner as not to have to chase her all over the blossom quarter. You know how the neighbors are. But when he arrives to the top, he has no answer. And being a creature of rhythm, he knocks anyway. The boss says, "Who's that?"
"Me, baby, the king."
He said, "I'm my great guru, love, the greatest cat that ever swung on a horse, the greatest cat that ever put his feet down in the clean blue door to shine the light of the queen's eyes."
"Yeah, baby, it's a falling daddy."
Said, "Look at the uniform on daddy."
"Yeah, they got me stacked in here pretty good, ain't they?" "Of course, they got to put me on a horse to get me on a horse, but when I'm on, I'm gone. Says, I'm here, daddy."
"So what you got behind you, daddy?"
"Close the door, open the window." "Always questions. You chicks gonna drive me crazy yet." "What you got behind you, daddy?" Now she wants to know.
As she looks at it again, she observes there's something of high merit. She sees the culture and the beauty and the caliber and the magnificence, the shimmer of the jewels. So she knows there's something high merit. So she puts a little feminine con down on him. She says, "Now, here's Groovy. Here's Daddy. Busy on $1,000 bad dog trying to snatch that grave. But before he go, he gonna put something down." "Ain't that Groovy?" Said, "Well, you know how it is with his majesty the king, baby. Say anything, I'll jump off at any time." Says, "I'm hip, Daddy." Now she looks at it again. And with the utmost of naivety, having never heard or dreamed of a Chastity belt, she says to him with the very first flower of the thought of naivety, she says,
"What is it, Daddy? It's you, Chase."
He said, "What, baby?" He said,
"I suppose you could call it that, sugar."
He said, "Yeah."
"That's what it is, a jewel case." She sits down, she goes, "Ooh, what's the matter with you, baby?" So I just say, "Ooh." "Say, you know, you've been ooing a little bit too much around here lately, don't you?" So I just say, "Ooh, something crazy looking about it." He said, "You know, I got to get that grass." "And I know you're going to pick up on it too, Daddy." He said, "Well, baby, you know, there's some studs sitting around here in these castles. On the top of the hill. It ain't on the hook for the grave. You know that too, don't you, baby?" She says, "That's a living truth, and some of them cats jump up and high and hard." He says, "That's what I'm talking about, baby. Some night when I got my cats and studs out there, about ready to whop that grail into a sack, he said, one of them cats will be jump so high, boom, and so high, boom, that out of that castle, right in your boudoir, and this little gadget gonna give them the supreme surprise of their natural born life. Snap!" She goes, "Ah!" "Take this, Doug, don't you like me? I locked it. I took the kill. I went and saw it."
"Darling. Sugar baby, darling. There you're getting yourself all excited. But a little thing like that, baby. You see, it's just like a new pair of shoes, sugar. You gotta wear a little while. Before you get used to it, I'll see you in a rail."